Hello and welcome, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Remko Rinkema and you are watching Run It Back. And today I am joined by the one, the only, Jennifer Tilly, to watch some of the best Poker After Dark action I have seen in many, many years as we are diving into Lucky Charms Week. But first and foremost, Jennifer, how are you doing?
I am doing great. Thank you. It's really nice to see somebody from the poker community on my Zoom screen.
Oh, it's been too long, huh?
Yes, I've been kind of taking a poker break. I actually miss poker more than Paris or Rome or anything.
Oh, man, it's been really long since I've last seen you. However, I have great memories, and especially of this week, this show on Poker After Dark. Let me first introduce to the people who are new to this show what this show is all about. On Run It Back, we watch some throwback footage, and sometimes it's 10 years old, sometimes it's from last month or from last week, and in this case it is a Poker After Dark show from the beginning of this year. It's called Lucky Charms Week. You hear the tune, you watch the intro, you recognize the faces, as Antonio Esfandiari is also in this lineup. Jennifer and I have been working for a very long time to make this show happen, and I'm so happy that we were finally able to do it. If you guys have questions for Jennifer or myself, please send them in the chat. We are live today on three places, or in three places for the very first time: Twitch, Facebook, and YouTube. So if you have questions, please send them in. Don't forget to like this video, subscribe to the channel, do all that good stuff. That's the only currency I accept today, is likes on the video. That's all we need. It's all we need today on the broadcast. So then Jennifer and I will dive into this show of Poker After Dark. Jennifer, let me first ask you this question that I've never really asked you, and I've never heard this story from you, but I really want to know. How did you get into poker in the first place? Because that seems like such an interesting sort of story for me.
Well, I've always been really competitive, and you know, my dad, I didn't find out until after he passed away, my dad had a poker problem. So he was teaching me how to play poker. He gave me, there's a video game called the World Series of Poker. And I remember when we would be playing, we'd be like all into it. And his wife, my stepmom, would be going, "Dinner's on the table, dinner." And I was like, "Why is she so upset? We're just having fun." But I think that she was worried that he was going to go down that dark spiral towards poker degeneracy. And I honestly believe that I met Phil because my dad passed away. And I think he was on the other side. And he is like, "I'm tired of Jennifer dating all these jerks. I'm going to find a good boyfriend for him." And I think he went on the other side and he found Phil, and he goes, "And he's a poker player, even better." So I really plunged into the poker world when I met Phil. But I actually met him at the celebrity poker, what's that, WPT, the Celebrity Poker Invitational.
Yep.
So I met him there, and I wasn't looking for a boyfriend. I was looking for somebody that could take me around to the casinos and, you know, help me play poker, like with the big boys. Because I'd only been to a casino a couple times before that. The first time, Joey Pantoliano, that I was on the movie Bound with, took me to a casino in Lake Tahoe. And I was playing with all these guys that had John Deere heart hats on and everything. And I felt like, this is it. This is a big time. I'm playing with real money, and I won. And I just felt like I was a real badass. So I wanted that feeling. Like I've had a poker game at my house for about 20 years. We play 25, 50 cent, but it didn't seem like the big time. It was more like Monopoly, where everybody played every hand and we had a lot of wild cards. So I guess you could say Phil got me into the legitimate poker. Are we watching this hand? Is this a hand we should be watching?
We are letting the footage roll. And if you see something you want to say something about, we can say something. But for the most part, the footage is going to roll and you and I can just chat. But yeah, we are now in the action Lucky Charms Week on PokerGO. If anyone is watching and wondering what is going on here, well, we're just going to break it down for you, but also going to have some fun with it. If you want to watch the entire stream, Lucky Charms Week is available on PokerGO right now. By the way, we have a good deal. HSP is the promo code for $20 off your annual subscription.
So speaking of having fun with it, I just want to explain this hand.
Yes, go for it.
Okay, I've played with, can they hear the conversation back?
Not now, but I can turn it up if you want.
Okay, yeah, roll it back. And I'm just going to say, this was actually the very, very first hand of Poker After Dark. And I played with Silverman before.
Yeah.
We called him Bajet, or I think he had some new nickname. And he's a very solid, fairly tight player. So he opened under the gun, and I thought it would be really funny because he's kind of nervous if I just went all in. I mean,
I thought maybe
he had sixes or sevens or some hand that he could fold. Like if he had Jack King, he would fold. But unfortunately, he had ace king. So that was kind of the worst case scenario. I thought worst case, maybe I'd be up against a flip or something. So I sort of did it to shake things up right off the bat and make everybody nervous and think I was this wild, insane person. But I actually legitimately thought there was a very strong chance I could have the correct hand. So, you know, the best hand. And as it turns out, I did not have the best hand, but I wasn't fazed by the way that this started because this game, okay, Antonio invites me to these games all the time. And he's like, oh, Jennifer, do you want to come play poker after dark? Because he likes to stock his little aquarium full of fishies. And I know I'm considered a fishy. And so he'll always say, like, it's a buy-in. I remember there was one hand where I think we played a $360,000 hand, and the buy-in was $10,000. And that was another one of Antonio's extravaganzas that he put together. So when he says, I think this one was a $20,000 buy-in. So he said it's a $20,000 buy-in. My problem is I don't like to play with scared money. So when he says $20,000 buy-in or come play my game, I always want to make sure I have at least three bullets. And by three bullets, I mean $300,000. Because you'll look at, I don't know if we looked at the opening stack, but within 15 minutes, everyone has $100,000 on the table. So it's not really a 10-20 game. So when I said all in with my $20,000, it was like, not like a, oh my God, she's all in with this massive amount of money. It was sort of like a snack, you know, a sort of a portent of things to come. So even though I was off to a bad start, I didn't really feel like I was. It's like, you know, you go all in with ace queen, somebody, sometimes, you know, the player at the table has ace king and you lose your stack. But, you know, that was more where that came from. Look how cheerful I am. But the only thing is, when I was going into this, I showed up in Las Vegas with my little bag of money, which was actually in my box. And DRB somehow found out I was going to be there. So he invited me to a game the night before, which was Rob Young, JRB. And here comes my new money. And it's weird to watch myself playing poker without talking. Rob Young and Rick Solomon and Kevin Hart.
Oh, wow.
So I played the first night. I was up $100,000. I played the second night and I was up $120,000. I thought this is fantastic because basically you don't want to play good when nobody is watching. You want to play good on TV. So I was up $120,000, a couple people in the game left, and I thought I should leave now. And then I thought, well, I'm doing so well. I'm having so much fun. And well, what else am I going to do? Because I'd only played for an hour and a half. But, you know, after certain people leave, you're allowed to leave. So I just stayed and I got creamed. I got massacred. So now I'm coming into this game with a little bit less than I really hoped to have. And I was a little bit jumpy, like, whoa. But, you know, it's all how you reframe it. You don't want to say, I think there was some story about Napoleon, you know, how people are very into, tell me if it's an interesting hand, because I'm just talking, but where he tripped as he got out of a boat and he's like, oh, my soldiers are watching. They're going to say this is a bad omen. So he instantly acted like he was supposed to when he kissed the ground and he said, I claim this ground for France. So I felt like coming into the game today, I thought, okay, I'm going to reframe it. Not like, wow, I'm really having a bad weekend, but I'm getting all my luck, bad luck out of the way so I can just play good and really clean up on this show.
Let me ask you this. Mm-hmm. Antonio always invites you to these games. We know mm-hmm. Antonio likes to play, you know, the host, and he wants to be, you know, involved, and he buys it for 100K when everyone else has 20K. What has mm-hmm. the relationship with Antonio been over the years? Like, it seems so amicable. It seems so fun. But also, at the same time, you guys are both out for blood against each other all the time.
Okay, I'm not used to multitasking, so will you tell me if an interesting hand happens?
I
could have the sound underneath it, or will that be too confusing for your many viewers to have the sound really quiet underneath?
We have it.
Then I could be like Ali in the booth, just sort of talking over the people at the table. Or
It's probably too many voices, but what I can do
Okay, let's not have too many voices, but something interesting happens. Say to me, oh, this is a big hand. I want to ask you about this. Antonio really goes after me. And, you know, Antonio is one of the greatest players in the world, I firmly believe. What he has is that he can really tell, he can really read people. So he really understands that I have this fear of losing money. But he doesn't, there's a switch sometimes that switches in me where all of a sudden I don't have any fear anymore. And that's even more dangerous possibly for the other players. possibly for me. And I remember once he wanted me, you know, he said to me, Jennifer, you're a really good player, but when you go on tilt, that's when you need to just get up and take a walk. So he's like, just, you know, calm down, because I have been in situations where I've dug myself a really, you can see we're just mixing it up already here. Okay. Now I'm thinking ace, you know, my ace high is good because Antonio, he could have anything. Antonio's not afraid to pile in $100,000 if he thinks it'll get you to fold.
Right.
He sometimes knows exactly what you have. Like once he got me to fold the straight because he put in this massive amount of money and I was positive it was either a chop or maybe he had a higher straight. I didn't think he had a higher straight, but I didn't want to put all that money in the middle for a chop. And there wasn't that much money in the first place. Jesse, there's a commentator in Jesse May. He says, well, you know, if you don't go to the wedding, you don't have, if you don't dance at the wedding, you don't have to go to the funeral. And that kind of means if you're not really, really involved with a lot of money, then, you know, you can let the other person bluff you a little bit if it's not like a huge pot. What Antonio does, and I've been working on a long time, like, how do I combat Antonio? And I've realized if I have a lot of money invested in the pot, the bigger the pot gets, the more he's interested in it. So when I try to raise him off of a pot, it's not really raising him off the pot because he's like, wow, now there's $50,000 in the middle. Now it's going to get too big and Jennifer will be afraid and she will go away. So you don't play him like you play another person. He also, because he is very good friends with Phil, he started out this shtick like, I'm going to really go after Jennifer because it will really hurt Phil. But then I just think it became habit with him because he goes after me in a way that you would not go after any other player. He just really delights in torturing me. And there's a hand that I think you're going to see later on where I do a this is it. Let's watch this hand.
So let's just,
oh no, this isn't it. No, okay, there was a hand,
but you are getting involved here with the seven deuce, which I think is awesome. So we can listen in on this a little bit and see where this goes, and then you can break it down for us after. Because
this is not the hand. There was another seven deuce hand, I think. This hand is fairly, I don't know. I think I just lose with my seven deuce. Well, let's see what happens.
But yeah, so basically we can turn up the audio to listen.
Yeah, let's turn up the audio.
And see if there's any
conversation.
Although it's funny because I never really talk during when I'm in hands. But I have good banter in between hands. Okay, turn up the audio.
All right.
That was the best.
Evan Mathis looks scared. Was it
the color? I don't remember what happens here.
Mathis's first involvement here with a couple of tens, which are good on this queen high two diamond flop. Tilly.
Look at this. Hollywood meets
trying to
the,
take down the seven
NFL.
Deuce bounty on the button. Mm-hmm. Could prove expensive. She put in 1,500 pre. Three betting Mathis.
As you said, you're quiet and focused, so let me just say.
Yeah, it's a badge of honor to win with the seven deuce. In fact, one time I had seven deuce and Antonio had seven deuce and he bet, I raised, he re-raised. I was like, okay, I'm not putting in $100,000 trying to win the seven deuce game. And then I was just so bitter because he won the seven deuce game. We both actually had seven deuce. The key to seven deuce is try not to pile in a whole lot of money. Like a lot of times, okay.
Oh yeah, you get.
Now, why did your people go through 12 hours of film and pick this really inconsequential hand to show?
Well, I think it shows that you're not afraid and you don't back down and you gave it.
I thought it shows that I'm fallible and I don't win all the hands. But this hand, I think, that's coming up with Antonio with the seven deuce.
Yeah, well,
maybe I should talk about it when we get to it.
I remember that hand too. Yes, that hand is also in there. But yeah, mm-hmm. It is cool for me to see that, you know, you don't back down from anyone and you always pick aggressive lines and you always go after it, which is a lot of fun to watch. What I'm wondering is, do you really feel a big adrenaline rush or are you super calm in those moments?
I'm really competitive and I really want to win. And I would have to say when I go on tilt, I get this insane rage in me. And once I was on tilt and I think I was stuck. This sounds really terrible, but I'm not going to say how much I was stuck. I was stuck a huge amount and I managed to get it all back. It's not a very good story if I don't say the amount, but I managed to get it all back in 2 hours because I just get very, very sort of like this force of nature, like a tsunami that really everybody quails before my power. But then the flip side of that is I get stuck and then I just, you know, become like this raging tilt monkey, which is not a good thing. And I take a lot of chances, and I have this roaring in my ears, so I'm not listening to all the tells and clues that people are giving off.
But it also seems...
It looks like you're... Oh, I have the ace queen. Okay.
Right. It also is interesting because, like you said, Antonio is definitely, you know, given you a lot more action than perhaps some of the other players because of all that history that you guys have. Do you remember the first time you played against him in a significant game?
I do not. But one time I remember we were in Ireland and I had a three in my hand. I don't know why. And then there was a three on the board. So I had a pair of threes for bottom pair. I was positive that it was the best hand. And I know that Antonio is full of it. So he bet, I raised, he re-raised all in. And then I folded, but I knew I felt like I had the best hand. And then of course he showed a bluff and laughed and laughed, and threes was the best hand, but he loves to put me to the test.
Right.
But this is my favorite thing where Antonio kind of nods and he goes, oh, good hand. The thing with Antonio though, when I feel like money won from Antonio is three times sweeter than money won from anybody else, because he tortures me. And I'd say he gets the best of me so often. He really does have my number sometimes. And so I especially like if I win against him, not like, oh, I have the nine high flush and he has the six high flush. I like to win against him if I'm like bluffing like a crazy person, or if I take some weird line and hit like a gut shot on the river or something like that. And then he's really astonished because he can't put me on that hand.
Yeah, no, that is really interesting.
Hand, I'm just going to talk through it because this hand is really embarrassing. I was going to talk over it and hope nobody noticed, but now I drew attention to it. Okay, this guy docks somebody or another. I've never played with him before. You can see I'm being super aggressive. I'm letting him know I have a queen. You know, maybe there's a flush out there. Okay, that's not super aggressive. I checked the turn. I kind of don't remember it, but I'm very ashamed of how I played this hand. Wait, so he bets 1-7, I call. So then I lead out on the river I'm like, okay, well, you know, I know you checked the turn. I was trying to get some more money in the pot. I bet smallish on the river. This is one of those hands where I didn't really have that much in the pot. So there's like 8,000 in the pot. I didn't want to lose to this guy. I thought, well, if he has a queen, for sure he has a better kicker. Right. I thought if he has like a flush, then, you know, my queen is no good. And then I thought, you know, if he's bluffing me, which actually kind of didn't cross my mind, but I was like, God bless him. But it never really crossed my mind he was bluffing, because I didn't think after I showed that I really liked my hand that he would. I guess I would say I didn't know he had that in him. You know, you kind of look around the table and you sort of peg different people at, you know, you say, well, this guy does this or this guy is that. And I sort of pegged him as somebody that was, you know, pretty ABC poker. But the thing is, the television, they say when you put atoms under a microscope, the atoms behave in a different way. And what I didn't take into account, the television factor, a lot of times people who normally would not make a play like that think like, well, you know, I'm on television, I want to show a big bluff, or they're like, oh, I don't want to lose to a girl on television, you know? So I think this was his moment to show that he was capable of doing crazy bluffs. I mean, he shouldn't even have been in the pot with his hand 7-6 offsuit.
Right.
I mean, if you read the books, if you read Harrington on poker, he wouldn't be playing that hand. But I'm not going to point fingers, because I'm always in the hand playing hands that I shouldn't be playing.
But he just wanted to tell a story at home that he bluffed Jennifer Tilly on TV.
He wanted to tell a story. Actually, later on in the show, he asked if he could take a sip out of my beer. And I said, no, of course, because of coronavirus. But then he said, oh, I would have had a really good story that Jennifer gave me a sip of her beer. And I was like, well, you would have had a story. I mean, that may possibly not a really good story. And people are like, well, you could say you asked if you got a sip of her beer. And she said, no, but you know. I do think that sometimes people behave differently on television because they, you know, they just want to, like, they'll not fold where they should fold because they don't want to be bluffed. So it could have been something like that. Who knows?
Let me quickly address all our viewers on Twitch, on YouTube, and on Facebook. We are back on Twitch for the very first time in a long time, so find us on Twitch / PokerGO. We'll do a run it back twice a week on Twitch going forward. I see everyone in there. For the people who are asking, what is this? Because I see a lot of people new to the show. This is Run It Back. We are live, Jennifer and I, talking about the action and, you know, taking some questions from the viewers. We're keeping track of those. We'll tackle some of those towards the end of the show. We're keeping score of that list. And then, of course, we are watching Poker After Dark Lucky Charms Week, which is available in full on PokerGO if you want to watch all the hands. What we've done is if we cut out a bunch of the hands from two nights of the action and put that all together for this. So lots of big swings. This game was crazy action. We're focusing mostly on the hands that Jennifer played because, of course, that is the most exciting thing to watch for us. So if everyone is wondering what is going on, that is the update. Also, update, new season of High Stakes Poker coming December 16th, airing for the first time on PokerGO exclusively, episode number one. We just announced the lineup. You can find that on twitter.com/PokerGO. Really exciting lineup. And Jennifer, about the topic of high stakes poker, there's two memories that stand out in my mind of the first time I noticed you in poker. Of course, it was your bracelet win, which was amazing, which was really cool to follow. Me, I was in the Netherlands. I was following the WSOP. That was really cool. The second time I noticed you was, funnily enough, I was thinking like, this woman is really nervous and she's not even in the game. And it was when Phil was playing high stakes poker and you were standing behind him.
Yeah.
And you seem more nervous than any person in the room.
Well, you know, Phil was playing with his own money. A lot of the people on high stakes poker are playing with Full Tilt money or Poker Stars. Like they would put them in. When Phil and I did like Poker After Dark and High Stakes Poker, because we didn't have any affiliation, we were playing with our own money. That, and so, you know, people didn't really know that. It was a lot of money to Phil at the time. And he was like playing a little bit above his wheelhouse, but he really wanted to be part of the show. This hand, this might be the hand. I don't know. I didn't know he even had time. Yes, this is the hand. Okay, so I re-raised him. I'm terrible at poker stories. I might have re-raised him pre-flop. So he bets the flop. You know, we both know nobody got a piece of that flop. And I raise the flop. So I'm saying to him, I'm saying to Antonio, I have a pocket pair, which is, you know, it's reasonable. I think I re-raised him pre-flop or called a raise pre-flop. I was so busy thinking about Phil not playing with PokerStars money that I got distracted. Okay, now I'm like, now I'm doing a little play like I have a queen or possibly my pocket jacks are still good. This is, you know, very reasonable. I put out there $9,000. Thanks God for graphics. $9,000. He's got nothing, nothing. Right. He doesn't even have a draw. Maybe he can hope to hit his ace. He calls the $9,000. And I'm screaming at him afterwards. I'm saying this was a very well-constructed bluff. Now, if I had, you know, ace, jack, ace, queen, pocket, whatever, I still have the best hand the way I'm playing. Look at me. There's no tells at all. No tells, not even a flicker going across that beautifully made up face. So I'm looking at my, I'm doing the thing. I'm even taking the pause. Like, how much can I bet that will get me paid off? I'm doing that whole thing, time and tell and everything. Great. So now I bet, and he knows I'm scared money. $17,000.
All right, let's listen to what is being said. I'm very curious.
Oh, queen ball maybe? I really don't believe you.
How can he not believe me? I bet the flop. I bet the turn. I bet the river. I raised pre-flop or call the raise pre-flop. How can he not believe me?
Oh, I'm such a fish.
My nemesis.
Reaching for the chips. Feigning as though the call is a foregone conclusion and then shooting a quick glance over at Jennifer to see if there's any physical reaction. Antonio, the absolute
all
best in
the
spot.
These commentary cracks me up. Look at me, no physical reaction. Just sitting there like my inner monologue. So, wow, I really hope he pays off my value bet. That's what's going on right there in my face. Not like, Jesus Christ,
she gets picked off.
I hate this game. It's so
worse. Oh my God.
Yeah, somebody said, oh my God.
I cannot believe you called me with an ace high.
Wow.
Try to bluff me. That's not nice.
I did a very well constructed bluff.
My kids are going to watch this someday. That was a very well constructed bluff.
I checked blind, and then I raised you on the flop like I had a pocket pair. Do you remember that part?
I remember.
Yes, I raised you on the flop.
I remember.
And then I let out on the turn.
And I remember that too.
And then I fired a third barrel on the river.
Told you to do something.
I would have folded.
Everybody should have folded. I should have
folded too. For the people in the chat. For the people in the chat, just let me know. Would you have folded? Great. Let me know. We want to see some yeses or nos. Would you have folded to the bluff?
I think that was a great bluff.
You know what I think? I think it's a free roll because Antonio knows that I'm careening out of control when I get on tilt. So he's like, and like, what is $50,000 to him or whatever it is? I don't know how much the total was, you know, 20,000, 30,000, because he is the $18 million man. But this is the thing which a lot of people don't understand. A lot of times you'll see, you know, they'll isolate a hand and they'll be like, oh, what's going on here? Oh, Jennifer's raising with 2-3 suited. That's not a good hand. This is why I love the PokerGO, the Poker After Dark, the live streams, is that because I'm hoping I'm going to do something really interesting, clever here, but it's because it's the whole game. It's the cumulative game that's important. So Antonio knows if he is wrong there, he just had a feeling, but if he is wrong and he pays me off, it's a small price to pay. If he's right, as opposed to if he's right and I go on tilt, and then perhaps there's lots more money where that came from. So I think that's what's going on. And I do believe he goes after me more than anybody else.
So Jennifer, so, let me get you up to date.
This is sickening too.
Yes, it is. But let me just say this. 90% of the people in the chat are, I would have folded, definitely folded, would have folded, would have folded, would have folded. Mm-hmm. I think that you would have bluffed everyone in the chat, myself included, but Antonio somehow find a way to do it. And then this hand comes up, which is super crazy because, of course, Antonio then just basically flops the nuts on you when you have a super strong hand, which is just...
I have the open-ended straight draw and top pair with a really good kicker. And you take into account that Antonio bluffs me all the time. He knows I'm on tilt. I don't know how far after that other hand this is, but he bluffs me all the time. So you never believe anything that he does.
Right.
So here I raised 10,000.
And you have a monster hand, especially against Antonio.
Yeah, he's doing a little dibby-dabbity acting.
For the people in the chat who are asking.
I don't believe him. He makes it 18,000. Maybe I believe him. I don't know. Let's hear what I say.
Yeah, this is a unfortunate spot.
Can I put the sound on? Maybe I say something like, I don't say anything. I just call.
Which she calls.
Well, you know, I do have a straight draw. I mean, how am I to know he flopped the nuts? He's like such a lucky bastard.
Right. Well, that
because nobody ever believes when Antonio has a hand because he's always bluffing so much or raising you off. He can always raise you off a medium pair, or you know, he can always move you off your hand. So, I'm starting to like probably not have a very good feeling here.
Yeah, this hand does not go your way,
it's not,
clearly.
Yeah, I'm sure it's not going that well.
But it's. I think the hands that don't go right are just as important as the ones that do go right because they tell the whole story of how you end up, you know, with a big stack in the cash game. Because people will think that you're on tilt because you're losing, you're stuck, and then all of a sudden it goes the other way, and then you win even more because of what happened prior to that. One quick question I want to address from the chat: if you are trying to subscribe to PokerGO, use the promo code HSP for $20 off your annual subscription. I just wanted to mention that because I saw a few people ask about it. So HSP is $20 off the annual sub. Yeah, this hand is pretty nuts because, of course, you know, of all the hands that Antonio can have, he happens to have the queen.
Right. And he has one of my outs, too.
Yeah.
So the beginning of this game, everything was going wrong. And that's really bad, too, because you can start thinking, like, I'm really unlucky. And then you make substandard decisions based on the fallacy that you are an unlucky person. So I think shortly after this, I take the walk that Antonio told me once a long time ago I should take. So,
right.
And then I'm like, why couldn't I have a set? I would love if we got it all in, Antonio was good, and then I suck out on him. But I actually prefer if our hands were reversed. But see, the thing is that Antonio will play pretty much every hand that I'm in because he knows I have like psychological problems.
I mean, it's tough too because you have so much history.
He goes after me. Yeah, we have some history.
And you don't want to get bluffed, of course.
Yeah, I mean, but what, after I bet, like, I don't know what I bet, like 40,000 or whatever on there, I didn't have very much left. Now here I'm saying, like, maybe I should leave. Maybe I should leave.
Can we give a
This dress is actually very cute in real life, but it looks like a big sparkly Bodan tent on camera. But it's okay when I'm sitting down. Sit down, Jennifer. Okay, there. Now I look good.
I was gonna. Mm-hmm. I was just gonna say this dress looks amazing. I mean, you came.
Oh well, thank you.
You came to play. If that's what a dress says, basically.
Well, when I'm on television, you know, when I'm playing poker in a real tournament, I just kind of dress to blend in. I think everyone feels sorry for me because I think I said I should leave. And then I said, no, I'm not going to leave. I'm going to stay and play some more. And I think I lose one more hand. And then I disappear for quite a while. And then everyone's like, oh my gosh, it's so quiet. While I was gone, we learned a little bit about Shaheen and Doc. I forget his name, Doc. And, you know, we learn stuff about the other players while I'm gone. Like,
We watch the upcoming hand, I want to know from you, Jennifer. Mm-hmm. How much does poker mean to you in your life? Because I can tell you're really passionate. You really love the game. And so does Phil. But what does it what does it really mean to you? I mean, this whole year, you've probably had more time to reflect on life as a whole.
Oh, my gosh. I have deuce seven again. And I think I'm just like, oh, my God, deuce seven again. Of course, I have it against Shaheen, is a really solid, tight player with the ace, king, raise all in. Of course, I'm forced to fold. I don't think I won a single deuce seven hand in this entire 2 days. You know what? I really love poker. And when I won the World Series, my ex-husband, Sam Simon, once said to me, the worst thing that can happen to you when you go to Las Vegas the first time is that you win. Because now all of a sudden you think you're lucky. You're always chasing that high, you know. You're like, I'm really talented and I'm really good at slot machines or whatever. So I went to Las Vegas the very first time I went to the World Series of Poker, because I used to play that World Series of Poker game all the time that my dad gave me. And I actually wrote in my journal, one day I'm going to go to the real World Series of Poker and win a real gold bracelet. And the first year I went to the World Series of Poker, I won a gold bracelet. So it makes you think like, wow, I've got a knack. You think you're like that girl Harmon in the Queen's Gambit. And I was like counting on my fingers, like how old am I and how many more years do I have to play the World Series of Poker? I started thinking about how many bracelets I wanted to have so I could be like some sort of, you know, poker savant. Cut to many years later, going to the World Series of Poker, playing mini tournaments. I would get close. I mean, I have a lot of caches, but it really is not very easy to win a bracelet because, you know what? Everything has to go your way. Like there's so much variance and, you know, you have to win all your races. You have to basically ride a wave. I mean, you can amass a huge stack by bluffing or, I don't know, doing stuff. But also, too, things have to go your way. There was that one time in the World Series of Poker where two players both had pocket aces and one of them four flushed. Here, you see this, and Antonio just came along for the ride all the way to the river just because he thinks he might be able to get me. You know, unfortunately for him, I have a really good hand, or maybe not. Oh, he's saying I have a full house or I have a flush. He's like, give it up, Tilly. You're never going to beat me.
Right.
I have your soul. I own your soul. He's saying, did I call? I called. I look happy.
No, this is the hand. So for the people who didn't hear it, he says he has a full house, but he doesn't. So he's basically like almost angle shooting, but you guys are friends, so it doesn't really count. But he's like, he says full house, and he shows his cards, but he doesn't have it.
And he's laughing. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Really,
yeah. Yeah, he's delightful. But at this point, I'm so conditioned that Antonio always, no matter what I have, he always has something better. Because I've been kind of beat down at the beginning of this game. I think by the time I took a walk, I was down $120,000, which is not a good start to a game, especially when you spent the night before playing to like 4 a.m. with Rick Solomon and Rob Young, you know?
So give the fans, and we have tons of fans watching right now, a little bit of an insight into what we never get to see. You know, what are the guys like Rick Solomon, JRB, Kevin Hart? What are they like when the cameras are not on and you guys are playing a friendly game, which clearly...
They're pretty much like, this is why I love to watch, you know, Phil and I were in Peru and we are watching Rob's game every single night. And if I hadn't been in Peru, I probably would have tried to play Rob's game, even though it was pretty... rich, was a little rich for my blood. But this is why I love to watch those guys, because number one, Rick Solomon is like, he's like from another planet. He's like, he plays like really weird all hands. You can never put him on a hand. The first time I played poker after dark, remember they had the new iteration, they decided to bring it back. It was a $250,000 buy-in, which I basically mortgaged my house because I said to Phil, everybody's going to be watching the new Poker After Dark. Everyone loves Poker After Dark. So this was, Maury goes, Jennifer, I'm going to get a lot of rich businessmen. I was like, I can beat a rich businessman. But then I found out that Rick Solomon was going to play. And I was really nervous because I play with him so many times on home games. He's a little bit like Antonio, that he seems to have my number. He's fearless. Money doesn't mean anything. He could have anything. You know, he could have 4-7. An offsuit, or he could have pocket aces. So he's very, very hard to read. So I was like, oh my God, I don't want to play Rick Solomon on TV, but I really want to play this. So the morning of that show, I was walking down, I was looking for the ballroom where they're filming it, and I saw Rick Solomon and he was leaving. And I go, Rick, doesn't the game start in 10 minutes? And he goes, oh, I left something in my room. And what happened was I showed up, and instead of rich businessmen, it was like the greatest poker players of all time. It was like Doyle Brunson, Antonio Esfandari, Johnny Chan, I think JRB was playing, all those people. Rick saw, he's like, one of the greatest things about Rick and where he's made millions of dollars is game selection. He looked at this lineup and he's like, you know what? I forgot I have a dentist appointment. But I, conversely, was so happy I wasn't playing Rick. I was like, give me, oh, and Phil Ivey was playing too. I'm like, give me Phil Ivey any day. I'd rather play Phil Ivey than Rick Solomon.
Wow.
Because Rick is so unpredictable, and literally he has no respect for money. I'm not gonna say respect, but he's like Antonio. If he can pile in $100,000 and make you fold your middle pair or even your top pair with top kicker, he's going to do it. And I love playing with people that are super gambly. So when we were watching Rob's game, it was just like sitting at a table with those guys. Rob Young, I love him. He has like such a wicked sense of humor. And JRB too. JRB is so funny. Like I used to play with JRB and Bobby Baldwin in Ivy's room. The two of them, I mean, Bobby was JRB's straight man. And he would heap so much abuse on JRB, but in a really funny way. Like when we would play in Ivy's room, everybody would be telling, and they'd tell like, you know, Rick Solomon sort of degenerate stories. Like,
well, you did do the best impression of
it. How we behave in the bad old days, which is something no lady wants to be around. But that's the thing why people like to watch them, because they're very authentic. They basically are... When you're watching, you're basically watching them play poker. They're not playing up for the camera or anything. You know, they're not running around being goofy or being a character or anything like that. They're just enjoying their life, and they all are really smart and have great senses of humor.
Yeah, I think that's the cool thing about poker, is that it brings people together from all walks of life. Mm-hmm. As long as you have the buy-in available, you can sit mm-hmm. down. So right. I'm sure over the years, and people are referencing Molly's game in the chat, mm-hmm. and they're asking if you've ever played on that. But over the years, you must have seen so many different characters come through. Like, were you ever in that game? Did you ever play in games right. like that in LA or in California in general?
Right. Let's hope I fold here. I mean... He's pretty. I'm like, there's something going on that I don't know about. I guess I figured I had some outs. Who knows? Oh, I have lots of outs. I have 9 outs.
That's plenty.
That's a lot of outs. Okay. You know what? I did not play Molly's game because when Molly was around, I was playing fairly small poker. Like I was playing 25-50, so I wasn't playing him. But I ended up playing with all of those guys after Molly moved to New York, pretty much everybody in the book I've played with. So when I saw the movie, when I read the book, when I saw the movie, you know, you kind of know all the stories behind it. I did not like Molly's game, the movie, much because I felt like it was very disrespectful to the poker community. I feel like, I mean, no, people were like, oh, Molly's game, it's a fancy game, and she has like plastic chips from Walmart. But also too, like people were not even adhering to the basic rules of poker. They didn't even do research. They wanted to make Commerce Casino look really seedy. So they ran around giving everybody cigarettes and cigars and putting drinks on the table, which is like, you know, it's been a smoke-free casino for a long time. So it was just sort of, and there was a guy who was the advisor that's supposed to make sure right. everything is realistic. And he kind of timidly went up to the director and he was like, you know, this wouldn't really happen, or, you know, the betting doesn't go that way. And the director, I forget his name, Aaron Sorkin, he He says, who gives a shit? Poker is the most boring game in the world. I'm here to make a movie.
What?
And I felt like you would never say that about, if you're making a movie about golf or you're making a movie about, you know, you would basically, or chess, you would adhere to the rules of the game. And people do have contempt for poker. Even when you look at that James Bond movie with the ridiculous hand, where everybody had this, had a better hand than the person before. I said, you know, the only way that that would work is if everybody was cheating. And that would be a very good twist. Everybody's cheating, but James Bond is the best cheater because he's here. Antonio's trying to do a number on me. And, please. Okay, yeah. I was like, don't insult me by not calling my value back. So here I get a dab back. But I do feel like poker is one of the greatest games in the world. And I don't think there has been, I think the Cincinnati Kid comes the closest to showing what it is like playing poker when they had that all night game and people were sleeping on the sofa and, you know, taking turns. I played games that have run for like 38 hours where the dealers are calling up other dealers like, can you come over? And the host goes to bed and he wakes up the next morning and we're still playing. And, wow. You know, I think that there is a really good movie, a very gritty movie about poker and the depths of degeneracy. And I don't think it's like Jessica Chastain in her Hervé Légère dresses, you know, and her daddy issues. I felt like that wasn't a poker movie. It's more of a courtroom drama.
Right. So as far as, you know, you know people in Hollywood. So Jennifer, mm-hmm. You can't get Sorkin on the phone and let him know that the betting doesn't go that way?
No, I can't. And I think he's a brilliant writer. And I've enjoyed all his movies. Let me say that just on the very slim chance that he wants to... here I knew I was behind, but I had that flush draw. So here we go. Bingo, bango, bongo, as the late, great Mike Sexton would
this
say.
This is the quickest Jennifer call I've seen in a very long time. Snap call.
Yes. Well, you know, I do a little bit of acting sometimes if I'm going all in and I want somebody to come along for the ride. But, you know, there's no sense in. I learned this from Phil Hellmuth when I played in tournaments with him. He does this thing. It's really funny. It's kind of obnoxious, but it's funny. But it's actually, you know, where they say, like, if you're going to, you know, cut off somebody's something or another, just make it a quick, clean cut. So sometimes somebody says to Phil, they go, I'm all in. And he goes, I call. And he pushes all his chips forward in a big, sloppy mess. But he does it almost instantaneously as if to say, I've just been waiting for this moment. But, you know, it's great because you don't know where you're at. He doesn't do the, You know, sometimes you have people, they have like the second nuts and you go all in and they just go into the tank. I don't know. I think they're savoring the moment. You start thinking like, oh, maybe I'm going to win here. Then you start hoping for a call like, well, if it's that hard of a decision, I must have the best hand. And then they call and they have like, pretty much the nuts.
A little side street here.
You're looking at this hand here. This is a hand that never should be. Like, why is Antonio calling me with 7-3 off suit? It's not even 7-2 off suit.
Right.
This is a hand that should never be. I don't know what position I'm in, but.
I mean, this represents very well the relationship between you guys, this hand.
Oh my God, he's such an asshole. And I say that very affectionately. Okay, look at this. I got a little more. I'm straight.
Stone okay. Nuts. Stone nuts.
I enjoy this. Let's see if I can get any more money out of Mr. Antonio. I love watching these things because sometimes I get really scared. Like, please don't do anything stupid, Jennifer. But the game is already over. Okay, now maybe if I check, he'll pretend like he has a flush. Please check. Check.
Very casual.
Look at my little sly side eye. I'm like a cat. Like hoping the mouse will fall into
and he falls for it
trap.
Too.
And I get another $11,000 out of Mr. Antonio. And then I do a speech because, you know, he could have the flush. I'm pretty sure I call. If I don't, I should just give up my poker playing player's card. But, you know, you can never be too careful.
That's true.
He knows I'm afraid. Whatever I'm playing scared money all the time. He knows I'm afraid.
It's really important.
You know, this would be a much more entertaining hand if I didn't go into the tank for so long.
Well, it's understandable, too, because you have to go through the...
Well, I'm like, what is he holding on for?
Right.
You know?
All he's out for
Are we listening to Antonio taunt me? Let's to him taunt me.
If I was bluffing, I probably would have barreled the turn.
Why would you barrel the turn if you have a club? I mean, just to call the turn is sort of, it's sort of conducive of somebody that's on some sort of weird flush draw. Oh, I raise him. Yeah, baby.
Gentilly with the speech check raise, huh? You made a flush, Gentilly?
Well, I'm like, if he likes his hand, I don't know. I'm just like, I don't need that. Phil used to say, never bet on the river. You only get called by a hand that can beat you. Yeah. And I've seen it many times. I remember once somebody had like, this guy kept wanting to fist bump me after each hand. You know, it's really weird, but when you win, somebody else loses. So even if it's Antonio, you don't want to like overtly, you know. So, although I do talk, I said, here's another hand. What's happening here? Oh, yeah. He has a jack. Oh, wow, how the flush draw. Okay, right. Let's watch and see how this plays out.
All right.
I have a pair and a flush draw, which is a very strong hand. A pair and a flush draw, very strong. I'm 50%. Of course, Antonio's loving it. He just thinks I'm a crazy bluffer. Please let me get there.
You put in the 3-bet, too, which is, like, very, very strong.
Yeah, I'm very strong. I mean, Jack 6 offsuit is not a very good hand. So see what I say? He plays every single hand. And I'm very unfortunate he has position on me here. Oh, now I'm in my flush. Let's see. Am I like, I'm the little bird with the broken wing. Oh, maybe somebody made a flush. Oh, I wonder who. Oh, no, now maybe somebody has a full house. I will flush. Check Tilly. You know why? Because I'm like, well, if he has a full house, let's find out right now. That's why I put the bet out. I didn't want him to bluff me off my hand. But, you know, he could easily make it $60,000 and I might go away.
That's tough. Yeah, that's tough.
Yeah. Oh, he hates to lose to Tilly. Tilly money is the sweetest money in the whole world to Antonio. I don't know. Is this after I came back or have I gone away yet? Do you know, Remko?
I don't know. We cut these pretty tight because there were so many hands to pick from that I didn't even see if you went back or came back.
Yeah, I did actually leave for a very long time. He does this thing where it looks like he's going to call. Of course, he's not going to call. He's a pro. He's not going to call. But he does see there's prime bluffing. Yeah, he's thinking to himself, she can bluff. She has a flush. She can bluff. She has a full house. And then I'm like, oh, yeah, you know, and this now that doctor guy fist bumps me again. I'm like, bro, that's like such a bro move. The fist bumping.
Fish bump is also kind of a funny.
Okay, now I'm all like really hot. Like this is actually happening in the moment. I'm going to go turn the air conditioning off.
Yeah, go for it.
Entertain the fans.
I will entertain the fans. And with that, you know, thanks everyone so much for watching on Twitch, on YouTube, and on Facebook. We have so many viewers today. I really appreciate it. Don't forget, by the way, to like this video, especially on YouTube. We're down a few likes, and I see all you guys in there. Sebi and Wisco Baron and all our regular viewers are with us. And not too much time for shout-outs today because
this
we have
so much.
This is
funny. I'm watching this because I'm like, gosh, I'm involved in every single hand. I
you
play
are.
Almost every hand, and I forgot that you cut it together with just Tilly hands.
It is. Well, that's the thing, though. Mm-hmm. You and Antonio especially played so many hands over the course. And by the way, this is 2 6-hour sessions boiled down to 90 minutes. So obviously, it's just tons and tons of action, and we don't even see the other players
play
much.
So now Antonio has the flush, of course. And I probably don't believe him. I thought there'd be more hands where I got
this hand is
of
amazing,
Antonio.
By the way. This hand
is?
Yeah, it's an amazing hand. Yeah.
I hope I made.
Jennifer,
amazing.
just enjoy this one. Just enjoy this one. This is a great hand.
Oh, dear. I can't imagine how I could beat him in this hand. I do not. It's probably an amazing hand in the way that I don't know. Put some sound
on. What to do, Miss Tilly?
Look, he talks at me. Look at him. Taunting.
Whatever you do.
Like I'm an animal in the zoo.
Do the right thing. Because Phil's watching, and we don't want him to see you doing the wrong thing.
See, he mentions
poker,
Phil again.
It's really all about the right thing.
He always brings up Phil. And you know, sometimes in the back of my mind, Phil and I play very differently. I mean, Phil is a professional poker player.
I thought for sure I was getting raised.
What's happening here?
You make the call.
Oh, I don't think I have much left. This might be before I left.
Bingo,
bingo,
bongo.
See, but this is the thing. He can't put me on a 3. It's hard for him to put me on a 3. Why would he be playing a hand with a 3 in it, right? For value on
I mean, you'll see. You'll see. The chatter gets better and better.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. I wish I had more money in front of me. Oh, no, I think this might have been after I came back.
God, I'm such a
okay.
freaking fish. It's amazing. It really is amazing.
He's just amazing.
I mean, why do I bet? I'm just such a ding-dong.
He might think I have an
amazing.
Ace.
It's actually amazing what a ding-dong I am. Why in the world would I bet?
I like when Antonio talks to himself.
You really held on with a three?
No, really? Nobody would. That's where it's good to be dum-dum. Who would hold on with a three?
Well... Gentilly. What a legend. Such a legend.
He says that. He doesn't mean it. But that's the good thing about playing a substandard hand.
No problem.
Is that when you
no
hit,
problem.
People can't put you on it.
Why would there be a problem with
the
it?
Old
no
Gus
problem.
Hansen style.
Mm-hmm. We all know where he's at now. I think he's playing in high-stakes poker.
That'll move right there.
Gus Hansen, right?
Is almost
not on the new season. It's Americans
oh.
only.
Situations just Every, to everybody see wants him. Get any sort yeah. of micro-reaction that suggests somebody is...
Is it hard in a moment like this to keep
I
keep
like
your
how Ellie is whispering in the booth like he's at a golf game. Any sort of micro-reaction he's looking for. Some sort of tell off of Jennifer.
Very much be on the fence here. I'm
like, no shit, Sherlock. Poor Ali, I think he like wakes up. He's like, oh my God, I have to say something. Jennifer, stop talking. Because I think it's pretty early, easy for him when I'm. This is now. This is nice, right? He calls call. And I throw down
He's
my
on.
Hand.
The first big misstep of the
it's
session.
The funniest thing is to see his face. The doc fist bump tries to fist bump me again, but I didn't notice.
So that's $160,000.
I actually do feel bad for him. You know when somebody. When you lose, I mean, the little pots, it's like all fun and games. But when somebody like loses like a big pot, then there's sort of like a sort of moment of silence for the bereaved. You know, usually you're a semi-pro such as myself.
So if you have a winning or a losing session, how does that influence you? If you win, you go to Louis Vuitton the next day to reward yourself? Or if you this lose, you go to Louis Vuitton the next day to, you know?
No, this is my, when I have a winning session, it's so great. And I usually go to, is it called Juan Sierra? You know that Spanish restaurant in the Aria?
Oh, yeah,
I go there.
Yeah, I know what you
okay,
mean.
Okay, I go there. I have bacon-wrapped dates, a suckling pig, bread and butter, and a big glass of red wine. And I just sit there, and I feel, like, really smug and happy. And then there's a slot machine that I like. It's called, it's what's that one where you play 10 hands at one time?
Oh, you mean... Ultimate what? X, Ultimate X. Poker.
Ultimate, oh, yes. And then I go into the little private room and I just sit and I play that hand, play it because it's really relaxing because you really don't have to think much. I just like to relax my brain. Like a lot of times after the show, Antonio will invite me out to dinner, but it's weird. You've been social for 6 hours, five, 6 hours using your brain. It's really weird. You just want to sort of decompress a little bit. And if I lose, I kind of have the same. I kind of have the same post-game strategy because if you win, you're really happy to have your bacon-wrapped dates and your suckling pig. If you lose, it's sort of like comfort food. It makes everything better. Okay, here I am. Okay, this is after I went for a walk and I came back. So what happened is I had a new – I got into that sort of rage like nobody is going to beat me. So I came back. I actually had a little better luck, but I came back and I was playing a lot more. I guess I would say I was playing a lot better. And but I'm thinking Antonio might not have known I had switched gears. Like sometimes you have to be really careful in poker to notice when people switch gears because all of a sudden they're going to start playing in a different way. Like I almost always start out these sessions being very frightened of losing my money. And then after I've lost about $100,000, I kind of don't give a fuck. I was like, well, I'm already down so much. I mean, I'm either going to get it back or dig a deeper hole. So here, this was really strange how it played out. You know, I have almost a nut flush. I'm really hoping that I can get paid off. Antonio, as you can see, has
squadoosh,
as the great Norma Chad would say.
Exactly.
But I didn't know. I didn't know he had squadoosh. I had a feeling that he might, And then also too, a lot of times when you bet on the river, even if you think the my battery's running low, even if you think the other person is going to fold, sometimes it's a good strategy so they can't see what you have, you know, so you don't have to show your hand and give them clues to how you play. Okay.
And there he comes.
This was insane. So he thought, he's like, I'm going to represent that I have the flush. Unfortunately for Antonio, I, Jennifer Tilly, already had the flush. I'm not slow rolling. I'm just like, could he possibly be so lucky that he has the nut flush? This is how frightened I am.
Jen, it doesn't take long.
Oh, yeah, but you heard Ollie say it doesn't take long. Right. I mean, sometimes my brain moves very, very slowly, but I do have to kind of check all the hands that can beat me. I failed math twice. That's why I had to go to college in the United States, because Canada has a much more stringent, what do you call it, qualifications for going to college. In the United States, you only need math 10. In Canada, you need math 11. So I have what's called math anxiety. Sometimes when you see me on the stream, I'm literally counting under my breath. Sometimes I put my hands underneath the table and count my outs on my hands. But it's funny because when you think of poker, it's like I'm sort of a feeling player. Like I don't say I have 11 outs, but in my mind, I think I have this many, you know, I have that many outs. I have, and sometimes you'll hear me screaming out, oh, you have 7 outs. And then everyone snickers because they only have 5 or whatever. But I kind of don't care. I just like when I'm at the poker table, I just like to say whatever pops into my mind. So here it's always tricky. Look, he's got the really high flush draw and I have top pair, top kicker. And then the thing is, if Antonio doesn't make his hand, then he has to bluff. And sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't. Let's see what's happening here. I really feel like it's almost impossible to flop a flush. I mean, it's been done. But I also operate under the assumption that nobody really has anything. And so now Antonio's like, checkity-deckity. Okay, I didn't do anything very clever there. I just hung on. Now I'm looking for cocktails. Cocktails?
What is the go-to cocktail, though? Do you have a favorite? Okay,
this is the second day now. Here we go.
Second day.
Well, we were drinking margaritas here because we were ordering from Javier's, and they have really good margaritas at Javier's. But usually, like, if you're playing with GRB or, you know, some of these really elegant businessmen, they usually order a really good bottle of wine, see new day, new outfit. And then I'll have some, you know, I'll have a glass of the wine, which they're having. Margaritas are a more fun drink. And you'll see on the second day, the margaritas are flowing.
The jalapeno margarita from Javier's is probably my favorite drink on the strip. Have you had that?
They are so good. They're excellent, excellent. Look, here's me, and I raised to 3,200. Like, in what poker book is Jack 3? Oh, no, what does he have? King 3 offsuit, a good hand.
Right.
I guess the beat Jennifer in every hand I have position on her poker book, I guess.
It's really interesting because people in the chat are saying, are you watching a heads-up game between Antonio and Jennifer? Because
well, that's what everyone's thinking. Yeah, I know this is all cut together, you know, but Antonio pretty much all during day one and day two, pretty much I got into it with Antonio so much. I mean, I think we probably played like, you know, 40% of the game, the hands.
And you came out of
Antonio is just like hanging on. Obviously, I have, you know, I have the second pair. I don't have now. He's going to be like, oh, I'm going to pretend like I have a 4, which is really in his wheelhouse.
But it's funny because you ended the first day with almost 400K. So you had a big winning session after a rocky start. And then the next day.
I think it was up $140,000 or something. Do you have those stats there on the first day?
I believe it was 140, yeah. Yes. And then Antonio on the second day to bully people around buys it for 200. And you do the same strategy as day one. You buy it for 20K and see if you can run it up.
I like running it up because when you run it up, and then sometimes people go like, But this, I love this. I think I fold. Look at me. Do I fold? I think I remember I fold. If I don't fold, then this would be like, what's Antonio say?
He wants to show a card.
Okay, let's hear Antonio and his banter.
Well, yeah, okay, you're bluffing. I know, you're bluffing.
He was bluffing.
Not a lot.
20, 30, 40, 50. 66. I have 1,000 left.
60?
Stop it!
That's pretty good.
But the battle to begin.
I'm sorry. I know.
Well, the thing is, whether I had it or not, I was gonna do
That's
it.
That's my style. I bet when I'm ahead, I'll fold when I'm behind.
You fold it.
I'm proud of that fold. Actually, I kind of remembered it because I did watch this again recently. Yeah. Now this one was such a fun day because we had Perkins here, and you know the coronavirus was just starting, and there's nothing fun about coronavirus, but he was the only one that was concerned, and he kept saying like, oh, I'm reading about it, I can't wait, I got on the break, I gotta read more about the coronavirus. He was very, very worried about it. And Perkins is a pretty brilliant man. He had some unlucky beats in this particular session, but I remember we started with the margaritas, and I don't know what Antonio just kept ordering. Rafts of margaritas were coming in. There was so much margarita action on this particular game. When I play in home games, I usually do not drink because a lot of times, like I used to drink on Poker Night in America, which is pretty relatively small buy-in, like 5,000, 10,000, you know, because I feel like when I'm on television, it's a different, just because I'm a performer, I feel like it's more about putting on a show. That's why I wear the outfits with the low cut and the makeup and the jewels and everything like that. But, you know, real life, when you're playing poker, it's, you know, you're pretty much playing a game with good conversation.
Right.
I knew I was probably good here. That's why I went all in. You can kind of get a feel from around the table, like where you're at. Like sometimes my psychic ability is good. But, you know, ace jack, I mean, it's not that great. King queen is a pretty, you almost weirdly, the ace will play if it runs out bad. And what I loved about this guy, Mathis, is that he always wanted to run it once. I usually, on television, like to run it once because it makes for a better show. Like, there's nothing more anticlimactic when there's a huge pot and then both parties take it back. But we are playing with our own money.
Right.
And so usually I'll say, well, if the hand is above, you know, $100,000, I'll, you know, we can run it more than once. Phil always says it's good to run it more than once because you smoothify your position. That's
right.
What he calls it smoothifying your position. I used to always say, because like I said, I'm bad at math. I used to always say, I'm only going to run it once, because if you run it twice, there's like, it opens up so many more possibilities. Then you have people calling you when you have the best hand because they have a draw and they think they can get you to run it three times. Mostly on television, I really admire Rob Young that he just runs it once. And then Ali in the booth goes, and remember, Rob only runs it once. And then your heart starts pounding because you're living vicariously through the people on the screen, and you're like, oh my God, this is such a huge pot and only one person is going to win. But sometimes I've run some small pots more than once, because sometimes you can see it means the money means a lot to the person that is like, oh, hey, can we run it more than once? Or, you know, you feel bad, you know, so it's, I try to only run it once, but then sometimes, you know, you get stuck running it.
So let me just quickly interject here. People are wondering who Mathis is. It's Evan Mathis, former NFL star. So we had some NFL versus Hollywood action there in that hand. Evan Mathis, great guy, right. Super friendly, and probably the largest biceps ever to appear on Poker right. After Dark. For the people that
it was
are
a
watching,
long time ago. I think they were calling him muscles or something like that.
Oh,
I
yeah.
think I called him the first day. I said, oh, we've got some eye candy for the ladies.
That's awesome.
And they took a vote and they decided on the first day that David Silverman, they said the vote with the viewers that David was the best looking. But then he said, I think my wife called in and voted a bunch of times. Now this Bunara.
Yeah.
Okay. I really like him. He's a Brazilian poker player. He made the final, not Brazilian.
Belize. What's
that? Belize. I knew it started with a B and it had a Z in it. He made the final table at the World Series of Poker 1 year. His daughter is married to, his daughter Amal, who's also a great poker player, is married to Antonio. So there's like a little bit of family things going on in here. And I actually, oh, okay. I won't tell you. We'll watch this hand. And let's see what happens here. We could turn the sound on.
Yeah, turn the sound on. Oh,
not going to be enough to
and
shed Bob.
We got action, boys and girls.
Here we go to the turnstile.
Julie, I didn't invite you to a knit fest, right?
I know.
Now Bunara picks up the little flush draw on the turn.
Oh, you got to look now?
Got to look now.
Put yourself in Tilly's shoes.
Inspection.
How disconcerting is it to put in the four bet, get call pre, fire this board, and get called. Now, Diamond rolls off on the turn.
Not that disconcerting. I never feel anybody has a flush, really.
Happy to see the six of clubs on the river, which is no
help. All in. Just going for it.
I didn't know he hit his 10. But, you know, I knew he didn't have a king. I was like, well, I'm pretty sure he doesn't have a king. If he doesn't have a king, he could possibly fold. I don't know. Sometimes I hear words coming out of my mouth, like all in. And I'm like, who said that? And it's like, oh, it was me. Cool it. Just chill.
Oh, that's amazing. I do. This is a perfect spot, though. Like, you put a lot of pressure on him. Calling with the 10 is extremely tough. He doesn't have the king, most likely.
He called it. Look, but this is how they disrespect me. He's calling with 10-8 offsuit, a 3-bet, you know, hoping for a situation such as this as he hits his 10. But then, you know, you don't really know. Like, why did I 3-bet? Do I have pocket jacks? Do I have pocket queens? Do I have king, queen, ace, king? You know, that's the problem sometimes, because I've run into it all the time where I'll call with a weird hand and I'll hit top pair and then someone has an over pair and that's all she wrote. So anyhow, I'm just like...
So would you say that your style is you are you a bluffer, or are we just seeing you bluff a lot on TV?
I like to bluff. And I think a lot of times that's the only way you can win it, because, you know, you'll get two people in a hand and, you know, hopefully it's only two people. I don't usually bluff into like four or five people unless I'm pretty sure that no one has anything. And then I think they will think I would never bluff into four or five people. So once in a while, that's like, you know, a really big coup when you manage to take down a bluff against a bunch of people. But you can kind of get a feeling like if people are interested in the pot or not interested in the pot. And a lot of times, like, you will do like have a sort of pre-flop jostle and then nobody connects. And then it's kind of basically the person with the most balls wins. Lots of times you can't take it down by just... You know, when I used to start out playing poker, as we all did, and my friends got so mad at me when I became, you know, sort of.
There we go. He fooled you. The bluff gets through. Fooled.
Yeah. And I never heard the end of it because he kept asking what I had. And then I didn't tell him, you know. But a lot of people, they have people sending them the hands. And so then he went back and he found out. And I just, for the rest of the episode, the show, he kept saying, you owe me one. You have a target on your back. You bluffed me. So sometimes it's good, too, because then you get more action. Like I say, it's not so much the individual hand. It's like what they think about you. Like I remember once I was playing with Phil Hellmuth and then he folded something and he's like, he called me and I had, you know, a really good hand. And he goes, well, she's a crazy bluffer. She bluffs all the time. And, you know, I was like kind of pleased. Oh, like, is that what I am? Like, it's funny that you don't know what people think about you. Like, I used to always tell my girlfriends that we play in the celebrity tournament. I'd say, if there's an ace on board on the flop, I said, just bet. They always think the girl has the ace. So it's like that was basically my advice. And when I play celebrity tournaments, I always think that the cute girl has an ace. But then I don't realize that sometimes people are watching me on TV and they're watching some of the things they do and they think that perhaps I am bluffing him. This was unfortunate. I'm bluffing into a set against the mighty Perkins.
Who has a
what
very?
Do I have? I have a gut shot. There.
He has a very creepy 3D doll of himself that looks very too real.
It looks exactly like him, but that was a bad luck doll. And then I think one of the other players later in the game asked if they could borrow it. And to me, I was like, "Ooh, that doll's got a bad mojo. I mean, you need to take that doll home and smudge it before you use it in another game." Because Perkins did have some bad luck in this session, and when he lent the doll to somebody else and that person had all that bad luck too until he gave the doll back. So
I mean, speaking of dolls, is the Chucky doll good luck or bad luck?
Well, I only had the Chucky doll at the table one time, and that was his name? Uncle Ron. Poor Perkins. Like, you would never think anybody is drawing to a gut shot, although it doesn't necessarily look like a gut shot. 3-2-3-ace-2-3-4, but it is a gut shot. You know, but how can you put me on this hand?
Right.
You cannot put me on this hand. I would not put myself on this hand. But now here's where I was like, oh, because I did that thing where I started with a small stack and ran it up. And that's unfortunate when, because afterwards he was like, oh, I would have, lucky, I would have paid like 3 times that amount, you know? So then you're like, oh, I could have won more, which I probably could have. I probably could have raised and he would have called because very difficult. But that was, I think, the start of the day. I started with 20 and I started ran it up to whatever it was, 39.
Yeah, that was
if it's it. But yeah, so but that was kind of I was got off to a good start. Okay, here's 7-2.
You can't help yourself when you see 7 deuce, you just have to go for it.
Okay, this is a sick hand where Antonio had 7 deuce also, and Antonio moved me off my hand. You know, sorry to give away any sorry for the spoiler alert. But usually I just call with the 7 deuce because when you raise in the 7 deuce game, it sets off alarms like, oh, maybe they have 7 deuce. So all of a sudden people start thinking about 7 deuce. So I just called. Now, Antonio.
I think he makes it 10. Yeah, 10,800.
He makes it. Yeah. So he raises. He makes it 10,800. He figures everybody called. Nobody's that committed to their hand.
Bob is already Bob? Questioning his life choices.
Bob doesn't understand that we have this insane rivalry, that he's stuck between the Jennifer Tilly Antonio Esfandaria vortex. So he's like, Jesus, Antonio raise and, you know, and what, and how can, you know, I've got pocket eights. He doesn't understand. Now I think, oh, I just, I should have re-raised. I should have made it $30,000. So, and then PokerGO cuts us together. Like, this is a great clip. Jennifer getting, Jennifer losing 7 deuce off. It's always slightly, slightly poker centric. Kind of humiliation when you lose with the same hand as the other guy that won because he just bet more. And that's always like really embarrassing. And especially because in the booth, they'll be like, oh, look, they both have the same hand. Who will win? Who is the most clever?
Well, what
the
I
answer
always,
is usually not me.
What I always find is that it's so funny and so easy from the sidelines to talk about how people are playing. You know, we're all chat pros, so to say. We all know best watching from the sidelines. When you're in the moment, Antonio puts 10 dimes out there. It's pretty tough when you have 7 deuce, and it's no longer an easy pickup there to win some chips. Let me quickly address the crowd here as we have tons of people watching. I appreciate every single one of you. I'd love to shout you all out, but there's just too many names for me to go through. But do let me know if you have any questions for Jennifer. I'm keeping track. So at the end of the show, we'll get some of those questions in. And please don't forget to like this video and subscribe to the channel. I do this show twice a week. And on Tuesday next week, we're watching more Season 7 of High Stakes Poker in anticipation of Season 8 airing for the first time December 16th exclusively on PokerGO. Use promo code HSP to take $20 off the annual subscription to watch all the poker that you can ever watch, and of course new episodes of Poker After Dark and High Stakes Poker. And today we are watching Lucky Charms Week on Poker After Dark with Jennifer Tilly. This show is from the beginning of the year. Jennifer and I are live, so keep those questions coming and we'll keep you guys entertained with some more action. How was that for a promo?
That was wonderful. You don't, you know, Phil, a lot of times he'll watch like instructional videos and he speeds it up like 1.5. You don't even need to be sped up 1.5. You talk really fast, like naturally, because you're a pro.
I need to keep up with you though. I'm trying to get a word in here.
This is probably not going to end well for me. You know, even if you had like ace, king, ace, queen, whatever. I mean, it's so seldom Antonio has an overpair. I wouldn't have called the pre-flop flop raise except for it was Antonio and, you know, suited. So I bet 25,000 here. He calls. Probably after that, I think I'm done. You know, I'm probably done.
But this is also what makes that rivalry between you and Antonio so tough, because top pair against Antonio is like having a set against someone else.
It's true. Now look at my face. Okay, let's hear what I say. I don't know. I'm probably just like.
Table. Yeah, you're going after me.
Great question.
See, I think he's going after me.
This is unbelievable. When she's against Antonio now, she's talking.
Boss, like.
Sideways. Back forward to here. Yeah, that's
unbelievable.
That's it, right? Yeah, that's it. You guys want to make sure.
Everybody's
Why did you put
astounded.
That extra 50,000 on the table?
That's
now
a,
you're going
that's
after me.
A great
me.
Question.
You know, and I might call. If I do,
this
I'll be very
unbelievable.
Ashamed.
Unbelievable. When she's against Antonio now, she's talking. Against me, not a word.
No, because it's all I have to do is go all in. It's like, no, I'm just, yeah. It's not like I'm giving off information,
right.
And then I'm going to re-raise him. Antonio, what do you have?
I don't know what you could possibly have. But I know that you knew that I meant to call, and then I raised by accident.
Oh, that's what happened, pre-flop.
What did you do?
I was trying to. I raised by accident. I meant to call.
I meant to call, and I threw in the wrong chip. That's why I got into this insanely huge hand with such a substandard holdings. And then I was like, fuck, I threw in the wrong chip. But I was like, don't let him know.
So basically that one moment sort of snowballs into this situation.
It snowballed.
Right.
So Lois says if you like bobble your chips or something weird happens, you know, pre-flop, he says you should just give up because the hand, don't play the hand. You know, poker players have all these superstitions. You know, I think I call. But don't worry, fearless viewers, it all ends up okay. It's like sometimes you can have one bad hand, one hand where you are not like the most clever person on the felt, and then end up winning overall. I'm just saying that in case people turn off their TV in disgust and go to see what's in their refrigerator, because later on you will see some fantastic poker by me, Miss Jennifer Tilley.
Well, that's also the beauty of this game is that the back and forths are so massive. Like if you're having a down day and you're stuck a buy-in or two, you know, you can just quickly turn it around in a cash game like this where money is just splashing around the way that it is. We got a funny question coming in on chat that I'll just ask you during this moment. Someone says, you got to ask Jen about the watermelon and the margarita blender Uncle Ron had.
Oh, I don't remember. I remember Uncle Ron had all these props. Oh, I never finished my sentence, but he did bring a Chucky doll, and it was the creepiest, like sort of weirdly smashed, like a Chucky that had been run over by a truck. So we had a lot of fun on that with Friday Night Poker. I loved Uncle Ron. We had that guy from Barstool
Smitty.
Sport. But he was pretending to be, but he didn't tell me. But he said he was pretending to do a parody of a really asshole professional poker player. But he did it so well. I just thought, like, oh, he's being so mean to me. And then Uncle Ron was kind of standing up for me. And then about a third of the way in, he goes, Jennifer, you're a really good sport. I mean, we didn't tell you, but I'm doing a character that's like a jerk. And I'm like, wow, playing a character that's like a jerk and actually being a jerk, it's a very, very thin line. Because I have to say, some of the things he said sort of hurt my feelings. But I much preferred Uncle Ron's character, like the naked chest with three hairs on it and the overalls and the watermelon on a wagon, and the watermelon was his friend, and the blender and the Chucky doll. I mean, I had so much fun on that game. It was Friday Night Poker is fun. It's interesting in a different way because I think it's like a 5K buy-in or something like that. It's not, you know, obviously it's interesting to see people get obliterated and lose their net worth. And, you know, that's interesting. But it is fun to just see people having a good time at poker because that's what poker is all about. You see Antonio's doing this thing where he's like trying to flash me the card. Antonio, I think he gets me to call. I'm ashamed of that. But, you know, win them all.
We'll keep taking questions from the chat during this moment here. Jennifer, are you playing home games with Phil during these uncertain times?
No, I'm not. And you know what? I don't want to put this out there because I think the poker community on a whole is really, you know how they say honor among thieves? There's nothing like honor among poker players. And not to say that they're thieves, but I was so astonished when I entered the poker world and somebody would come by and say to Phil, he'd be at the table. They'd be like, hey, can I borrow 25K? And Phil would just pick up a chip and hand it to him. No, like, when are you going to pay me back? Unless, you know, sign here and, you know, let me send a blah, 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 blah. It was just be like, oh, yeah, sure, here. Okay, I raise, you know. And the people in the poker community, all you have is basically your word.
Right.
And if it gets out that your word is not good or that you don't pay your debts or whatever, then it's basically your honor is one of your tools. So, but I do believe with the online poker that there's so much ability, and I've heard stories, there's so many ways that people can cheat. And then also too, it's odd that sometimes I've read stories where people were cheating and everyone's like, yeah, so what, everybody does it, like in news using gossip. I'm like, that disturbed me more than the actual people that were involved in the cheating, that everyone was like, yeah, whatever. It's like, is it like such an occurrence that people are like, oh, it's no big deal? So with the online poker, I really do feel like even when I used to play on, you know, some of the poker websites when poker was legal, it's newsflash, it's not legal. It's weird because everyone's playing poker online right now, but it is not legal. But sometimes I go to my you know, I'd open up my computer and it would say, oh, you're involved in three sit and goes where people were cheating and oh, wow. we refunded your account like $36. And I'd be like, oh, but you know, you never know. I was once in a cabin once with Phil and some of his friends. And I'll try to come up with another name for him. I did a last longer with some of the people in the cabin. We were all playing like it was like a $300 tournament. So I just did a little last longer. And about half an hour in, I go, oh my God. I said, I think you're going to win the last longer to the guy I was in the last longer with, but thank God he was focusing. I said, I just did a bluff all in with some guy named Sleepy Eye Joe and he's thinking. I didn't realize that was my friend's name that was in the room. He folded and that was his computer name. It had nothing to do with his real name.
Oh, I see.
So that was very unconscious on my part, but there's nothing to stop like a bunch of people from being in one room and sort of consolidating their, you know, sort of like sharing information. So, what I
think that they also mm-hmm. might have meant with that question is, are you and Phil at the kitchen table at home playing poker?
Oh no, Phil and I were so competitive, and Phil hates to play poker with me. Here, this hand, this is my favorite hand, by the way.
Okay,
deuce three suited, and when I played the first poker after dark with Doyle Brunson, I lost my entire stack because I had deuce three suited, and he had deuce three. And he had 7-8 suit at 7-8. So here I hit my, this is why I love this hand, because now I've got my flush and I've got Perkins on the hook. And I love Perkins because he is totally fearless.
And your stack in this moment compared to the other hand against Bill is so much larger, so there's a lot more to win.
Yeah, and then it's never easy. Now the board pairs look like, but it was actually kind of easy, yes. But I called the all-in 39th. This is why people, you see them sitting down, and it's like, this is a $20 buying game. But a lot of people sit around and look to see who has the most money on the table, and then they match it because they don't want to ever be in a situation where they have, you know, nut flush against second nut flush and, you know, only bring in a nominal amount. I think if you're trying to... if you're trying to minimize your losses, you're coming from a bad place because you're playing scared poker. You're like, well, which I am so often. But I found that I perform a lot better when I have more money on the table. Yeah, because you're coming from the assumption that all the other people are going to outplay you and you're going to lose your money. So I'll only have 10,000 on the table or 20,000 because, you know, I could lose 10,000 five times and it's only 50,000 as opposed to I put 50,000 on the table. Okay, here I have a legitimate hand. Let's see what happens here.
Let's listen in.
I'll let you know.
And Antonio is three betting with his ace four suited.
He can tell him to play the next hand regardless of what it is.
Yeah, no matter what.
So
no matter
if he has bad cards, he'll even play it.
That
I raised because I knew he would call.
Of course, he doesn't want to fold to you ever.
Mm-hmm.
You can see, like, hold on. Let me pause it and go back a few seconds. Look at Antonio's face, and you can tell me what he's thinking because this is such a moment of like, this is just because of Jennifer. Look, I'm gonna go back a few seconds.
Let's see. Okay. Let's see. Also to get in a heads up situation.
Oh, this is also your stare, which I
look
love.
Look at me. I'm like a shark. That's my shark face. I'm like. Fuck you.
So
I look so crafty.
Look at how Antonio's face changes right now.
Wow.
Mm-hmm.
Pretty good interest.
Yeah.
You see how subtle it is? He's like, his lips are like.
Microtel. Right.
I don't even know what
one time each.
Wait, who gets
one? I love it.
Yeah. But see, he even knows. Like, he's like, well, if she has ace king, ace queen, you know, I can move her off of it if she doesn't connect. If she has pocket sevens and an overcard comes, he cannot resist. Now the pot is like big and juicy, you know? He doesn't care about the little pots. He cares about the big, juicy, bloated pots. Oh, this is like, oh my God, it's never easy, right? Look at that. He knows I don't have, you know, a full house. He knows I don't have a full house. And I'm like, eh. But obviously, I don't put him on a flush draw. I never think anyone has a flush draw. But, you know, Antonio is like one lucky motherfucker. So I just want to kind of not see. Look at him. Now he's really happy. He loves I put 25K in. He'll probably raise, I'm guessing.
Deep stacks, too. A lot of damage can be done.
Look how much money he has on the table. He has like $500,000 on the table or something, right? One, two, three, four.
He's got
three. He's got about $500,000 on the table.
Yeah, he's got 415 left, and you have 162. So
Yeah, he's trying to match Perkins, though. That's the thing. Him and Perkins probably have the same amount of money. He also wants to match the person who has the most money at the table. See, what did I say? I knew he would raise. He just raises here.
Jennifer, with this raise.
Any more chips,
I think I'm like, I think I go all in. I mean, what can you do? You have to go all in. I don't have that much money left, really.
The King of Clubs.
Oh, well, I guess I do. I've got about, what is that, 200,000? Yeah, but I mean, you're not going to call 77 and then, you know, take another card. You're just going to. All in, no more decisions. All the pain is over. You either win or you lose. Look at all this outs. Oh, my God. Oh, well, he's only 41% and he has 11 out. Okay, here I think I say it's over 100,000. Maybe we can run it twice. I think that's what I said.
400,000 in the middle.
Twice. We're running it twice. I'm going to smoothify my position.
Yep.
And you know what? I think I lose it on the first one, and then I win the second one.
It's always good to win the first one, they say.
I think I lose the first one. Who knows?
Right.
I get a lot of flack because I scream at the cards that I want to come out, but it does seem to work.
We need a red.
Yeah.
Red ace is no good.
We can send Antonio.
Red card.
Orbit. That's orbit.
That's good for me.
First
oh, that was
you.
Good for me. I did win the first one. I don't remember. So long ago. I love poker. Poker's the greatest game in the world.
What's a three do?
It's all fun and games until you lose your bankroll, right?
Yeah.
I really do have a poker problem, just like my dad. Poker degeneracy goes way back in my family. Okay, he won the second one. Now I'm on tilt. I'm like, why didn't I say once? Why did I say twice? You know, the thing is, when you win, you're just mad because you could have won more. When you lose, you're just mad. But you know, my dad, like, I'm half Chinese. My dad is Chinese. And and I found out, it's very much in the Asian culture, the gambling. I don't know why. I was really pleased to find that out. I didn't grow up with my dad. And my Aunt Marie said, when your grandparents came to America, they traveled first class, which was kind of unknown for Chinese people. They didn't travel steerage. And my great-grandfather went to UCLA to study medicine. Halfway through his studies, he had to fly back to China and cut his studies short and drop out of school because his brother had gambled away the family fortune.
What?
Which must have been sizable because they were very, very wealthy and traveled first class. So I feel like, you know, you can have the gene for degeneracy. You can have a gambling, you know, how though sometimes somebody will adopt a kid and then they have huge drug problems. It turned out both of their parents were junkies and they're in, you know, very Brady Bunch upbringing. You can have genetic markers for having a gambling problem, just like alcohol or drugs.
Wow, that's crazy.
Watch that. And I you know, my Aunt Maria used to write articles for Bluff Magazine about my poker games, and they started out like really fun and cute, like, oh, and you know, we're playing poker and we're traveling and, you know, we're in Aruba and I bought a conch shell. And then they started being these stories about like, oh, I'm stuck this insane amount of money and I can't go home, and then it turns to night and it turns to day and it turns to night. And my stepmom and my Aunt Marie got together and I felt like they should be admiring my brilliant writing because I'm a very good writer, but they were actually very, very worried for me because they recognized a degenerate when they saw one. Okay, this is, oh, I'm so proud of my, I make a very clever call here. Very clever.
I don't think you have a flush.
He's like trying to poker.
I have nothing.
I'm pretty sure you don't have
it. He even says it. He says, I have nothing.
The Jamie Gold.
I can only beat a bluff. Maybe can't
exactly
even beat a bluff.
She's up against.
It's 4,200. Look how big the pot is.
I'm going to think about it.
You don't think about it.
I think you really want me to call.
Could be double, triple, or reverse.
I know. I think I'm getting leveled. All right. Let me think. Think about it. Think about it. Think about it.
Think about it.
Think about it. Think about it. All right.
It's like jump boarding.
Evan.
Evan Easter.
Looks disgusted. Didn't think that.
Wow. Honestly. Wow. Tilly would call. I'm so competitive, you cannot let the other people win, even for a minute. You can't, because you know what? The little victories lead to bigger victories. Because if they bluff you and then you find out, then you start to lose your mojo. And it's just like when I grew up, I was really competitive. We used to have a, I would always like hit home runs with the baseball team. And then about eighth grade puberty hit. And all of a sudden, my home run could only get me to first or second base. And the guys were hitting the ball out of the park. So when I discovered poker, I was like, oh my God, this is like amazing. I can play with the boys. We can play with the guys, I guess I should say, with the guys, and it doesn't matter how strong it is. It's basically mano a mano. But the thing with men and women play very differently for the most part, if I'm going to make generalizations, guys have a lot of testosterone. And I always said, like, poker is like a big game of chicken. It's like dick measuring, like who has the biggest dick. Because sometimes you'll see hands and you'll be like, oh my God, how did that pot get so big with those substandard holdings? And it's because it's like the rams in the wilderness, you know, they're hitting each other with the horns and everything. And once you understand that, you just have to get in there and sort of headbutt also, even though you don't have any horns. You just have to say, there's something going on here besides just what's in the card, just the cards. It's, you know, it's a battle for dominance, really. It's like, who's the alpha male? And I always think I'm the alpha male. So and that gets me into trouble sometimes. But this is what I love about poker. And my favorite kind of poker is where nobody has anything. And that's where the Doug Polk, Daniel Negreanu heads up match is so interesting, because heads up poker, you have to play pretty much every hand. And it's not like a full ring game where, you know, there's nine people and you're sitting around waiting for your pocket aces or your, you know, top five starting hands. You kind of have to get in there and mess it up with whatever you have.
This
is a good play by Mathis. You know, he's like, he has 12 outs, but I'm still 4%. No, let's see. Here's where I show my betrayal of math knowledge. I'm 8%. I'm 8% on him. Oh, yeah, yeah. And Mathis also, too, like, he's a very macho guy. He likes to just run it once. Let's see what he's saying to me.
Tilly against Wreck-It Ralph.
It's over 100.
100 each.
What are you talking about?
35 in there.
Once is good.
Once is good.
Go once. Yeah, you're going to get there.
Not good.
Someone said to Mathis he was going to get there.
We'll see a red card.
Evan, what are you, like, 24% right now?
Stop clearing my action. Red card. Everyone has to be rooting for a red card.
Don't say red card. You know what happens if a red card comes there?
What?
I don't know.
What if it's a red ace?
No.
Yeah.
Oh, no. Small red card. I got two.
There we go.
Okay, and then I take it down. But I am, you know, pretty most all gamblers are really superstitious. And I really do believe, I actually read that, you know, if you read those ridiculous things that we women are all into, like, you know, The Secret or whatever, I did read somewhere that if you're focusing on a card, that it will manifest. And, you know, these are just things gamblers come up with to create the illusion that they're in control. And so instead of saying no queen, no queen, no queen, don't say no queen, say seven of hearts or whatever. Don't focus on the thing you don't want, because it will come. And I remember one summer, all summer long, I was filming a movie called The Initiation of Sarah. And we're in the middle of nowhere. So I was just playing poker online constantly. And I did like a sort of unofficial, like little experiment. And it did seem when I was focusing on cards that I wanted to come as opposed to cards I didn't want to come, it seems like I did better.
One funny,
but, you know, it's poker's crazy. The variance is insane. And
one funny thing I just showed the audience is that the dealer showed two more turns and two more rivers, and you won every single one of them.
So I did.
Even if you guys would have run it three times, you would have won every single one.
Oh, right, yeah. Sometimes it's just your day to win. And, you know, a lot of times you'll be playing against somebody. Sometimes, I'm sure you've been at these kind of tables, Remko, where somebody has a supernatural ability to hit cards and get, like, you know, better hands than the other person. If it's a cash game, you should just pack up your toys and go home, because it's not going to change. Unless you go for a very long walk, maybe you come back and you've disturbed the energy, the winning energy of the other player. But there really is a sort of thing where somebody goes on a run. Like, I've noticed sometimes if somebody wins a bracelet at the World Series of Poker, they'll have a really good summer and go on to win two or three more bracelets, and then never win another bracelet again for the next 10 years. It really is a phenomenon. And I think a lot of it is being confident. I remember once I was playing in a home game, and there was a guy that was kind of going after me a lot. And I had a pocket sevens and I bet and he raised and I re-raised, he re-raised, I re-raised. And he threw down his cards in disgust and said, you always have a better hand than me. And he stormed out of the room. And I'm truly surprised he had pocket kings. I honestly thought I had the best hand. But a lot of times when you see, okay, so here I've, okay, well, it's a race between me and Bunara, Bob. It's a race between me and Bob. And then Bob always has in the back, I mean, he's got ace, king, suited, which is like basically the best hand you could ever, one of the best hands you can have. I love the suited when you have ace, king, or ace, queen. You know, supposedly it doesn't really raise your odds by that much, but for some reason it's super juicy. It's so much juicier to have the suitedness.
Bob's here making it 40K with the
okay,
four.
Okay, let's listen to what he's saying. He's right. Probably saying, are you going to bluff me again? Oh, that's what he said all day. You
got actually, he looks a little buzzed up. Right. Yeah, two sips.
Yeah. Mm,
I have a good hand.
We both do, I think.
Nines are good, though.
I think, I don't know. Mm-hmm.
How much cheers. Do I have margarita?
How much do you have total? How much do you have?
If you're enjoying the content, by the way, for the people at home, please hit that like button, subscribe to the channel,
the
follow us on Twitch.
You have about 40 behind, so
margaritas.
Well, love. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I'm going to fold.
Insurance is available.
Oh, yeah, I think I folded there because, you know, I'm doing well. And you don't want to jeopardize. Bob was, he's a pretty strong player. And I thought, like, you know, I have pocket nines, maybe he has pocket tens, pocket jacks, who knows? He seemed really strong there. And I thought, do I really want to lose $40,000 with pocket nines? The answer was no.
Yeah, because that was going to go for stacks for sure.
I'm super happy to raise it to 10, but when he raises it to 40,000 now, there's a whole other story. That's more information that's coming in. I'm happy to lose $10,000 with pocket nines, but not $40,000.
Yeah, that's a big, big investment. People are wondering in the chat, Jennifer, besides poker, how have you stayed entertained during this quarantine? What other hobbies do you have when you're
home?
You know
what? It's really astonishing because I try not to say it because people make fun of me. I really have not left the house hardly at all. And it's just flown by. Yesterday we got a bread machine. Yesterday we made a loaf of bread in the bread machine. It was like magic. I mean, we could not believe that we just put these ingredients in the machine and 4 hours later we had a loaf of bread. And then my sister sent me a deep fryer. And I was like, you mean you can fry chicken without getting grease all over the walls and all over the floor? So last night I made fried chicken. I'm really turning into a good cook. And Phil, I had no idea. He's like a master griller, and he makes some really good pancakes, too.
Wow. So food and poker are the two main...
I'm doing all this cooking. We're watching a lot of movies. It's strange because all the things that I said I wanted to do, like Phil and I were in Peru on New Year's Eve, and you know how they say be careful what you wish for? We wrote down a list of all the things we wanted to do in the new year, and one was writing more, spending more time with my family, watching more movies, reading more books, doing more cooking. And I've actually ended up doing all these things. And because I'm worried about my family, you know, I feel like I'm, you know, the mother hen trying to get all the chickens under the roost. So I have all my family, I have Zooms with them once a week, just, you know, to look at them and make sure that they're doing okay. And, you know, I think the thing is, Phil and I are so happy. Like, I'm really, really lucky I have him. You know, when they say, oh, who would you want to be on a deserted island with? You know, Phil, obviously. And he's so entertaining and he has lots of ideas. And we've got, you know, he's got a million ideas. And, you know, he's sort of like a three-ring circus all wrapped up in one man. And and I've been spending a lot of more time around the house. I'm actually really, really happy. And so but I think you have to really mentally, I think you really have to say, I'm going to be happy, because instead of saying like, well, we're just going to wait out this pandemic when we can travel again and see our friends or whatever, you have to say, no, this is our life too. And frame it like, I'm so grateful that I can read and I can write and, you know, work on my projects and, you know, do my things and finally clean out the garage instead of saying like, well, life really sucks and how much longer is this going to go on? But you have to consciously change your mindset.
And in this
case, I'm really happy. I'm spending once a week. I talk to all my family. I have three different groups of family because some of my family doesn't talk to other members of my family. So instead of having one big Zoom, I have to have a bunch of little Zooms. So here we have the classic what is a classic race, and I probably win because I'm really lucky here. Let's see. We can turn the sound on.
Yeah, let's do it.
I might have just got prepay. Can I prepay?
Please, yeah. Poker gods, Acer.
Where's you again?
I'd like a rebate, please.
Please bless me.
You're saying please, so it has to come, right?
King. Yeah.
No, I'm not buying out. I'm just prepaying. Just
I'm talking to the poker gods. Memphis, I think, was a bit unlucky. Both days, I think.
Oh, that's so bad. Wait.
Board pairs.
Wait, I have a...
So sad.
Oh, God.
I had seven deuce.
You picked up really? A straight
and he only does it once, I think.
I did.
I think maybe I hit something on the river.
Acer King.
You have 15%.
He's 86%. Doesn't look good. Oh,
not
okay.
One of Tilly's six outs, and finally.
I just assumed that I was going to win that, but I didn't. How dare your staff put in a hand where I don't win? How dare
I know. I'll have a talk with them. Only winners. Only
I didn't
winners
remember that,
on.
But I was like, I prayed to the poker gods, you know.
You did all the right things. Another question's coming in. Do you like to watch yourself play poker after the fact? Do you use it to study or entertainment? Like, basically, the question is, how much poker do you watch?
You know what? I love watching myself. I remember once when I used to... Everybody in Hollywood plays this game. It's with this guy named Norby Walters, who's this great old entertainment guy. He knows everyone in Hollywood. And we go every week, and there's, you know, I mean, think about it with Mimi Rogers there and, you know, Tom Arnold, all these old guys like Jerry Vale. We play until quarter of 11, and then everybody would stop playing and tell stories about Frank Sinatra, because most of these guys knew Frank Sinatra, so they tell Frank Sinatra stories. Here, I think Julie wanted to go twice, so I think we went twice.
First time Julie gets involved?
Yeah, let's listen to what Julie has. I always feel funny when I'm playing with that.
The thing is, no one's going to win it twice.
There's no aces on the flop.
Whoever wins, win it twice.
Chop it up.
Do the flop, and then...
Julie is so sweet, and, you know, she can roll with the big boys. She plays in poker, what's it, Live at the Bike and everything. She's really, really into poker, and... I think this is like a little bit higher than she plays, but she really wanted to do it. She was, you know, really a baller. She played all the way to the end. She got felted and she put some more money on the table. And yeah, you know, it's weird because I like to encourage other women to play poker. I don't know why. It's like, it's not the same sort of thrill to felt Julie as it is to felt Antonio. But I think we did it twice and then we split it or something, or maybe I won. Who knows? I don't remember.
So I'm very curious about the story, though. Frank Sinatra stories.
Oh, yeah. So we all tell Frank Sinatra. Everyone would tell Frank Sinatra stories. Why did I start talking about Norby Walters?
So the question was, do you like to watch poker? And do you like...
Oh, yeah.
So,
oh, cool. No, finish the question.
No, the question was, do you like to watch poker? Do you like to watch yourself play poker? And is it for entertainment or is it to learn? And then you went to this game that you
Norby
played.
Walters. Norby Walters. I don't know how I went there. But
that game sounds much more exciting than whether or not you watch yourself play poker. So is that game just, you know, fun?
No, it was a lot of fun. It's like a $50 buy-in, and it was basically poker for fun. I have no idea why I went there. But I actually... Oh, that's why I went there. Because, you know, Jeff Ross, the comedian who does all the Friars Roast, he told me he was on Celebrity Bravo Poker Showdown. Remember, that was like in the early days when celebrities discovered poker and they'd be all confused, like, do I have a straight? Like, they wouldn't know what they had. And Jeffrey said he would just go on because, you know, comedians are always looking for places to showcase himself. And he said, I would just fold all my hands so I could think of better jokes. And I really like that attitude. I just thought, like, yes, poker on TV, it's a poker show. You're making a show. And I feel like, to myself, I feel like I'd rather, like, be I mean, obviously you don't want to lose your shirt, but is this the end of this?
We have burned through the entire thing.
Okay, well, good. Then I can finish my story.
Yes, finish your story.
Oh, and then on the second day, I won $180,000. Wait. 100,000. How much did I win?
I think you won 180 on the second night and 140 on the first night.
Does that sound $180,000 on the second night, which was my biggest win ever, which is why when you said, oh, do you want to do a run it back with Remko? I thought, the lucky charms, I had two really great nights. And so maybe it'll make me look like I'm like a super baller. But I really like that attitude. And when I first started playing poker, I remember... First of all, I was terrified when I first started playing. But then I sort of adopted Jeff Ross's idea. And I remember once on Poker After Dark, the old one, I was playing with Mike Matisau, and I had kind of the nuts. And I bet on the river, and Mike was about to call. And he goes, I'm going to call. But before I call, he goes, I have a call and a speech. And I was like, I knew it was a good joke, but I was like, I know he'll fold if I say it. And I sacrifice getting extra money in the pot for the joke. I go, can you call first and make the speech later? And he instantly folded. I knew he folded. He would fold. But I just thought, like, that's a really good joke. I'm sitting there with the nuts. But also, I just felt like that. It kind of makes me look dopey. It kind of makes me look dumb. But I just thought, like, sometimes when I'm watching the show, and I can't watch it with Phil, because Phil's always like, well, you know, you had 17% and the person and the odds and the such and such, and, you know, perhaps there and the blah, 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 blah. And I'm like, you're talking over my jokes. Like, when I'm watching to make sure the lighting is good, and I'm watching to see if I'm, like, entertaining or funny. And, you know, sometimes the people in the booth, you know, obviously people are watching because they want to know what's happening. They're like, well, I think Chuck Reyes is a very good alternative. It's like, wait a minute, wait, I'm telling my Frank Sinatra story. You're talking over my Frank Sinatra story. But, you know, Ali and PokerGO, this is why I love PokerGO, because he really does let it breathe. You know, when there's good banter or things going on at the table, Ali and Nick, they let it happen, as opposed to, I used to play a lot of poker games in England, and sometimes not the incomparable Jessie May, who was beautiful and understood that people wanted to hear Barney Boatman and Neil Channing and Luke Schwartz going at it. But sometimes you would have other people in the booth that would just talk through the entire feed. And I think when people watch poker on television, they like the idea that they have a seat at the table and that, you know, they're sort of one of the gang. And especially when you have, sometimes I understand that you'll get a batch of people that pretty much stare at the cards and, you know, make the GTO appropriate decisions all the time. And then you've got the people in the booth have to, you know, they kind of have to talk about how they had hot dogs or lunch, and it's not agreeing with them just to fill the emptiness. But, you know, when you have like great players or like entertainers, like I always love when Antonio calls me, even though he goes after me like I was gonna say like a motherfucker, but I'm like, oh, I'm swearing too much. But even though he really goes after me, Antonio's shows are always entertaining shows. Antonio is one of those rarities that he knows how to be entertaining on TV, and he's also a great poker player. And also when JRB calls, you know, he always puts together a good game with like really funny people. And when Phil Hellmuth calls, he puts together like interesting personalities. So it's like when I get called to do a game on Poker After Dark, I'm always thinking like, more is it going to be a fun group of people, as opposed to, you know, some people will say, well, are there a lot of fish in the game, or I don't want to play, you know, so-and-so who's number five on the all-time money list. But I don't care if somebody is like the greatest poker player in the world or number five on the all-time money list. If they're entertaining and they can kind of keep up with, you know, the banter and make it fun. Like that last game, you probably didn't see because I was talking through it. The one with Phil, with Perkins. I mean, they were rolling in the cocktail cart like every 15 minutes. But, you know, I wouldn't recommend to young people just getting into poker to drink copiously while you're playing poker. But sometimes it can loosen up a game a little bit. The games are really fun to watch when the wheels come off. To me, you can really learn by watching people play perfect poker. But I like to see, like, I'm a gambler, and I like to see people just get it in just for the hell of it to see what happens, or be at one of those games where people are like, where they think like, wow, this is a terrible hand and I probably have the worst hand, but how funny will it be if I win with this hand? And what will the expression of the people in the hands be when I turn over this hand and I've somehow managed to like flop a full house or something? So to me, that's interesting to watch poker where you don't know where it's going to go. And I think the last, the 2 days of this show, it was sort of anybody's game because it was a lot of those who dare. And mm-hmm. I'm talking about the players in the game. They didn't play safe. Everybody was there to have a good time. Everybody was there to gamble it up. And so it was really fun. Usually when I finish playing poker, I have a warm, funny, fuzzy feeling. Like I get separation anxiety, like, oh, this is my family that I took that I took money from. I don't want to go home. I don't want it to be over. And sometimes when there's a great game, you'll see on PokerGO or Poker After Dark that people are getting very melancholy. And everyone's like, let's keep the game going. But you know what? It's just not the same in a casino. It's when you're in that little circle of light, there gets to be a sort of like, wow, this is really great. And, you know, we're sad. It's over.
Right. I have a few more questions for you before I let you go. And for the people that are watching, get your final questions in right now for Jennifer, because we're still going to tackle a few of those and make sure that we hit on every single one of them, because we have so many viewers today. I really appreciate everyone coming
Thank
out
Thank you,
to the
everybody,
chat.
For coming and watching, and I hope you enjoyed it.
Exactly. So
go tell your friends what a great poker player Jennifer Tilley is.
Exactly. And don't forget to tune back in when we get to have you back on the show in
2021. Oh, my God. I was set to do the high stakes poker. Because it's one of those things where it's like everybody is so excited about high stakes poker coming back, and I want to be on the first episode. Everybody is going to watch, and it was one of those, let's mortgage the house. Like, I always see it like Monopoly. Like, what can I turn over? What little buildings can I turn over to scrape together? Because it's a very hefty buy-in. And it was going to happen. I was going to do a Poker Go with Jamie Gold, which was some sort of charity thing. Kitty Kuo, I was supposed to do Kitty's game, and then I was going to do high stakes poker, and it was all taking place within a month, and it was right when the pandemic started. And all of a sudden, I was feeling really anxious about going to Las Vegas, and I expressed it to people, and then all of a sudden, the whole PokerGO studio shut down, and then they started up again. But you know, the funny thing is, when you stay in the house, it's very, very easy. And the longer you stay in the house, the more loath you are to leave it. So when they did start up the high stakes poker, I didn't feel comfortable about traveling to Vegas. Although I think a lot of the people that are on the show, they got great players, are already in Vegas. But hopefully I can do the high stakes poker season 2, because that is a fantastic game.
Absolutely. So a question that I've seen multiple times tonight in the chat is, Jennifer, what do you think your 2021 will look like? Any roles you're looking forward to, any poker games you're looking forward to, or do you think that maybe you're going to just make more bread?
I'll make more bread. Well, I was going to tweet something. It feels like, don't tweet that. I was going to say, things I realize are not important during a pandemic. And I was going to say, highlights in my hair, long pointy acrylic fingernails, and showers. So I was like, oh no, that'll make you sound like you're the great unwashed. But it is funny how your priorities change. Like, you know, if you see me on those shows, I have long sparkly nails. Now I look at my hands and I'm like, oh my God, it's my mom's hands. My mom had real, like her real person nails. I think that I've rethought a lot of my priorities. You know, you rethink your whole life and how you live your life. You realize how little time you have left. You realize how important love and family is. And I feel it's funny because right now I'm like, oh, I'm never going to wear high heels again. But somebody said they think after it opens up again, it's going to be like the roaring 20s. Like everyone's going to be wearing sparkly things and dancing the Charleston on the tables. So I don't know. It's really interesting to see how it's going to be. But the one thing I miss more than anything is poker and live poker and doing the shows on PokerGO. And I think we were supposed to be starting the Chucky television series, and thank God they postponed it, because they would have to get somebody younger and sexier than me to play Tiffany, because I'm like, I'm not leaving my house. And a lot of my friends that have been working the shows have had to shut down because people got the coronavirus. It's still here, and I think we just have to have a little patience because it's just going to be a few months. But 2021, I think, is going to be a great year, and not just for me, but for everybody. But as soon as I can, I miss Vegas. I read every day, you know, my Twitter, like, how's it? It's, you know, poor old Vegas is limping along. They're doing their best. And I'm probably going to come back and play as much televised poker as I can. And I feel like I'm a lot better as a poker player. I'm really hoping the World Series of Poker starts up next summer, because I do want to start working on that second bracelet.
There we go. I hope
by the time I pass away, I have around 7 bracelets. I think it's possible.
Definitely.
It's possible. And, you know, if you believe, is that from Peter Pan? Just believe. But I do feel like a lot of times if I believe things, I can make them happen. We're going to do the Chucky series, which I'm in. I think we're going to start filming again next summer. And I also have some other series I'm attached to, and I'm still lucky I could do Family Guy. I do it in my closet at home. I record at home now. And I have another show called Monsters, Inc., which is from Disney. And it's all the original people from the movie, like myself, John Goodman, Billy Crystal. So I'm starring in that. That should be coming out soon. And I have another television series I'm supposed to do that films in Hawaii. Not sure what's going on with that, but I've got a million things going on. And it's funny because I feel like, you know, I was doing a Zoom, it was actually the Mike Sexton thing that Matt Savage, the tribute that he did such a masterful job of. And, you know, I came in, I said my little tribute. We all loved Mike. And then I was just watching on the Zoom, you know, how they turn your video off and everything like that. So I was just watching. It was about 4 or 5 hours long, and I'm watching and I'm crying. And then I went and I wiped off all my makeup because obviously I have to have makeup on TV. And then I came back in. I put on my pajamas and I was like sitting here. I was sort of listening and I was sort of texting it. All of a sudden I was back on the screen with no makeup and no bra, my pajamas. And I looked at the camera like, I said, oh my God, I'm on screen. You always hear about those people that are exposing their penises or walking around or going to the bathroom doing Zoom. And you're like, what a moron. That would never be me. But I was like, my chairman was like, oh my God, who is that troll? And so sometimes I feel like I hope the pandemic, because, you know, all of a sudden we have the vaccination. Like, I hope it doesn't lift all of a sudden because, you know, I've been having happy fried chicken and homemade bread and everything like that. It's like, well, no, I have to lose all this weight first. I have all these things I have to do. I have to, like, I would feel really horrible if the pandemic lifted and I still had cleaned out my garage. So when it all of a sudden seemed like it was going to lift really fast, I had that feeling of suddenly being caught unaware looking at the camera and being like, oh my God. So I'm gonna start. It's like amazing with 24 hours in a day that it's really impossible to find 1 hour to work out. But I did get a bruised heel. I worked out once and I said, I think I have a bruised heel. And Phil goes, oh, those are horrible. Paul Pierce had one and it lasted about 3 months. So I let 3 months go by. And then I was like, it still hurts. But you know what? Housework is really good exercise. And I have the little step thing that I have around my, you know, I have to crawl underneath the bed to vacuum because, of course, you know, we can't let anyone into the house. And I've, you know, just climbing on ladders and dusting the ceiling and everything. I don't really think I've gained any weight, even though I'm eating so much more food, because I'm just, you know, basically tiling the roof and cleaning the toilets and doing all this stuff that I used to do when I first arrived in Hollywood, that when I became successful, I thought I would never have to do again. And it's very interesting. It's very satisfying to have a very messy something or another and clean it up. So that's what I've been doing. I've been Little House on the Prairie, baking bread, doing housework, you know, reading books. Phil makes a fire and then I clean out the fireplace because you burn wood all night long. You have this giant heap of ashes. So it's amazing how interesting just living can be. And I used to just travel all the time. Like I go to Paris or Rome or Italy or Milan. I go with my friends. Sometimes I'd come home. I throw the suitcase behind the sofa and then I pack another suitcase and go. Sometimes I had 6 or 7 suitcases behind the sofa because I would say three weeks out of a month, I was not at home.
Wow.
So Phil's like, he's like, I love lockdown. He goes, it's like real life, except for you make me food every night and we get to watch movies and I have my girl all the time. So
that's amazing. I think that's a great note to quit the show on. This is amazing, Jennifer. Thank you so much for
thank you, Remko, and thank you for inviting me to do this. Thank you, everybody, for watching. You can tell I haven't talked to anybody besides Phil for a very long time, so I was just a torrent of words today.
I feel as though this was helpful for you, for me, and for the audience.
Yes, it was like therapy, but I didn't have to pay $300 an hour.
I'll send the invoice later on. Okay. All you have to do is promise me that you'll try to convince Phil to come on this show and he can pick whatever he wants to watch, High Stakes Poker, Poker After Dark, I don't care. Just try, because people would love to hear from Phil.
I will try. And, you know, Phil is massively entertaining no matter what. You know, the thing with Phil, and I'm sure everybody knows this, Antonio, Phil does whatever Phil wants to do. So it might be like all of a sudden he wakes up and he's like, I think I'm going to do that Remko thing. But, you know, I will mention it to him. And, you know, I know he admires you. We watched the Run It Back with Remko that you did with Daniel Coleman, and we really enjoyed it. So awesome. If he feels like it, he will contact you.
I love it. I love it. All right. For the people that are watching still, come back with me on Tuesday. It's going to be at 1 p.m. Eastern time watching season 7 of High Stakes Poker featuring the gentleman on the screen, Mr. Bill Perkins, as well as plenty of other characters, including Phil Galfon, Johnny Chan. We have a whole bunch of people playing in that lineup, and we're doing that in anticipation of Season 8 of High Stakes Poker, Episode 1, premiering on December 16th at 8 p.m. Eastern Time. Use the promo code HSP to take $20 off the annual subscription for PokerGO, and you get probably 75,000 hours of poker. I've watched all of it. I can tell you it's amazing. We have every single WSB main event. We even have the bracelet event where Phil Locke and Johnny Chan go heads up and Jennifer Tilly wins the ladies event. That event is on PokerGO. So if you're a real poker fan and you have not seen that yet, go find it. Just type in Phil Locke. You'll find it. It's going to be very easy to see. And on that note, this is the end of Run It Back. Thanks everyone so much for watching. Come back to me on Tuesday for the next show. Jennifer, once again, thank you so much from both the audience and myself. It was a pleasure.
Thank you. Good night.
Good night.